Hello everybody, my name is Sophie and welcome to another video. Today guys, the most anticipated read of the year, the biggest flop of the century. We're here to talk about Crescent City 3, whatever the fuck the name of the book is. Can anybody remember? Like really? I just call it Crescent City 3. Long awaited, 2 years to be specific, we've been waiting. And it flopped. It flopped in a way I could have never predicted. I finished it a few hours ago. And I was debating whether I should sleep a night over it and process what I just read, but I don't need that, guys. I'm ready to hate whenever. That being said, this is a rant review. I'm gonna get it out straight from the get-go that everybody knows. If you love this book, this probably isn't for you, because I hated it. I gave it 1 star. I don't know if anybody likes this book, to be honest. From the reviews that I've seen or the feedback I've seen, a lot of people are disappointed. And so I've actually seen a lot of bad reviews for once. It's quite charming. This is not hate on anybody who likes this book, who finds joy in it. That's great for you. Everybody can like what they like. I probably like things that you don't like. But fuck Sarah J. Maas. I mean, I'm bold to say that. Because do you want me to turn this chair around? Do you want me to do that? Mm-hmm. You see? But don't look at the hair. But if you also look at this shelf, I don't know how well you can see it. This is the Sarah J. Maas shelf. You don't see Crescent City 3 on there. Luckily, my bookstore didn't have it. So I just got it on my Kindle. I don't even know if I want to get the physical version now. I kinda don't. You guys really have to let me know your opinion on the book if you've read it in the comments below, because I did not think that I would ever rate a Sarah J. Maas book 1 star, and I was pretty certain I would give it 2, just because I felt bad. But then I was like, why the fuck do you, what the fuck? My review was actually a spoiler for the book, because I'm known for my amazing, funny, witty, for my 1 star Goodreads reviews, okay? And I always try to think of something funny to sum the vibe of the book up in like one sentence. And for this one, I was pondering over several different options, but I ultimately settled on something that was explicitly said in the book. Hand literally can't wear any underwear because his dick is too big. It says that in the book. As we all know, there were some controversies before this book released. Actually, maybe you don't know, so I'll just tell you. There were bonus chapters announced, and Sarah J. Maas always does bonus chapters, but I think it's for 5 different editions. So, for example, Barnes & Noble gets 1 bonus chapter. Then, I don't know any other bookstores, but 5 different bookstores, 5 different bonus chapters. And when she announces on her Instagram, and I talked about this in a podcast episode that I did, but I don't remember which one, people were appalled by this. They said, why the fuck are you making me buy 5 different books just so I can get the no one's making you. No one's making you, BB. BB? Oh my god, guys, I don't know what to do anymore. No one's forcing you to buy 5 different editions of the same book. Just read them on Twitter or Reddit. People are not utilizing their resources well. I wasn't bothered by this, but a lot of people complained about it. I just looked them up on Twitter, and let me tell you, you didn't miss out on anything. All that being said, this is probably the shortest intro I've ever done. But before I can really get into the rant, I of course have to thank my members. My members get my videos a day early, including this one. So if you're like, damn, I wish I would have seen this a day early, then become a member, become a book hater. They also get stickers for the comments and also exclusive content such as my movie commentary on Ruby Red. Yeah, that exists. And they get a shout out in my videos, they get to vote on my next reads, and so on and so forth. And my love. And my peace. My members are Haley B, Ashley Ranger B, Mrs. Preminger, Trinity ELW, Clara S, Kushimita, Deja, Queen Sif, Courtney, Haley Charles, Grace, Tallulah, Asteria, and Lacey Lace EDC. I love you guys. Also, before we talk about it, I want to give another disclaimer. This book was almost 900 pages long, so I will not be talking about every single thing that happens, and I will probably get some things wrong because I'm not that deep into the lore and everything. I don't really care that much. This is more of a chill vibe and an angry one. So if I get something wrong, I'm sorry. But also, I have to say that I marked maybe a total of 5 sentences in this entire book, which is very, very little. Oftentimes, I have up to 20 things, 30 that I marked to read out to you guys to show you what I'm talking about. With this book, everything felt so weird. For me, I didn't go into it with any explicit expectations, and I didn't watch any like prediction videos, because obviously, I think if you're still here, you know that this is like the grand crossover between worlds where Bryce at the end of the last book ended up in the Aquitar world, and everyone was like speculating what is gonna happen in this book, how is everyone gonna come together. And I think a lot of people are just also disappointed that those expectations weren't met, because that is the one big thing that people hope for from this book, and it wasn't delivered. She didn't do it. I don't know who they are. Sarah didn't do it. Sarah didn't commit to the bit, as the Americans like to say. I don't know what they say. And that was the only expectation that I had going into it. I didn't look at any like lore videos. I'm not that deep into it. I was when I was 14. I was really into it. Honestly, if you're here, you probably read all of the books, right? I'm sorry. Or maybe you didn't read any of them and you just want to know what the fuck is going on. That's also the video for you guys. Should we get into it, guys? I don't really want to. The book was so boring. I thought it was not possible to be boring. It was. We start the book with the hint. The hint is Lydia. And I don't even think that I mentioned her like at all in my last review. I don't remember what I said in the last video. That was 2 years ago. That's a different me. But I don't know if I mentioned her at all. I didn't really talk about her. I think maybe I mentioned her on the side. I don't care for Lydia, and I do not care for Rune, who turns out to be her maid in this book, which... Okay, now that I'm saying that, I do remember that I said that in the last video that I made on Crescent City, that they were going to be mates, and that's true. I just know a lot of people gave the book 2 stars and then were like, I'm just giving this 2 stars for Lydia and Rune because they're my favorite. And honestly, I've read better. We get her chapter POV. I don't even remember what it was. And then we get the first actual chapter, because that was the prologue, and it's Bryce in the Aquitar world. Very bold choice of Sarah to introduce us to exactly 4 Aquitar characters in this book and not any more. Okay, this is where the problem starts. The focus is on Nesta. I hated A Court of Silver Flames, guys. Watch the video. I have a whole video on why I don't like Nesta. I don't like her character. I don't think it was well done. And I know this is a very big controversy. If you like her, that's fine. But then her being the focus character in this book for Bryce, you know, left a sour taste in my mouth. No, honestly, I didn't think she was that bad in this one. I think she has become more likable since her last book. Whatever. The other main character from the Aquitar world is Azriel. And then we also get to see on page Rhys and Cassian in the end, in the very end, the last 10 pages. She is only in the Aquitar world for the first maybe 20%. And then she figures out how to go back. She goes back to her world, and then in the end, she doesn't even go to the Aquitar world anymore. She just opens the portal, and we'll talk about it. But why? Okay, I don't want to take everything ahead, so let's just talk about the book. Bryce is getting interrogated by Rhys, Az, and Amryn. Oh, we also get Amryn. Okay, first lie I told this one. Amryn is also there. See, I already forgot about her, because she's literally only there in the very beginning. They're interrogating her. They're asking her, what's going on? How did she end up here? She's in a cell under the mountain, and she's like, I'm gonna prank these bitches. The way the worlds are connected, essentially, is like the Trojan War. I think. I don't remember the Trojan War that well. I wasn't around back then. It's like the main characters are called Helena and Peleus, which is Helen and Paris. What was the other dude's name? Whatever. And so she's telling us this. They're kind of making the connections that 15,000 years ago, there must have been an event that caused some of the Fae to leave this Aquitar world and go into Bryce's world, okay? But they're realizing, since they're talking in ancient Fae, that this is annoying because they have to translate everything to Azriel, who does not speak Old Fae. And so they decide to, you know, help Bryce. And you can guess, if you didn't read the book, how they help her to speak their language. I'll wait. Yes, they give her a pill. They give her a magical pill, which makes it so she understands their language. I'm not sure what other option I would have liked better, but the pill was definitely very low on the list of things I would have liked to see. I figure out that she has the horn in her back and that it's like in a different language than old language. I don't even fucking know. And then they're like, what the fuck is in your back? It's glowing, after they give her that magical translation pill. It's glowing. And then the chapter and perspective jumping starts right after this. Because this first chapter is entirely in Bryce's perspective. And then after this, this is the last time we'll see this. That's not the case anymore. No! We have so many characters. We need to know about them all. I think the first people we jump back to are Hunt and Rune in the dungeon. And there's also a random dude called Brian or something. His name is not Brian. It's something else with B. I don't remember it. He's there for not even the plot. He's there because he doesn't do anything in the entire book. He was Daniqua's mate, and her name is not Daniqua, I'm aware, but I don't know how to say it properly. And I think I've said that since the first book, so are you trying to tell me that I can't say it this way? Guys, Crescent City was the first book I reviewed on this channel. It was the entire reason I made this channel. So we're coming full circle, okay? Me hating the first book and making the video about it, and now we're making the video about the last book of the series. I can pronounce the things however I want. He was Daniqua's maid, revealed in the second book. I don't think I mentioned him in the second book either. He has no relevance, he has no importance. The only thing he does at some point is bite of Rune's hand. Also completely irrelevant to anything. Shouldn't have done that, didn't need to do all that. Honestly, I'm gonna say it now. My hair keeps tickling my fucking nose. None of the side characters did anything in this book. You can tell me whatever the fuck you want, but we didn't need any of the side characters. This was entirely Bryce's book, and Bryce is the best person out there, and I want Bryce to become president. They're chilling in the dungeon of the Volturi. The Volturi are the Asteri, and this caused confusion in my last video. People were like, why the fuck are you calling them the Volturi? Because they are! They are like the Volturi! And so I will keep calling them that. I will. The blueprint of evil group. While they're down in the dungeon, they're of course getting abused. Tortured is the word I was looking for. To keep his faith up of freedom, Hunt, who is Bryce's mate and husband, is thinking about her, of course. In his darkest times, he's getting tortured. He has scars and burns and wounds all over his body. And the only relief he has is when he goes unconscious, he's thinking this. Oblivion beckoned, a sweet release Hunt had come to crave as much as Bryce's body entwined with his. He pretended sometimes that when he fell into the blackness, he was falling into her arms. Okay, but no. Into her sweet, tight pussy. It doesn't actually say that, it says sweet, tight heat. But you thought for a second it said that, right? He's getting tortured and he's not thinking about his lovely mate, how her laughter fills him with joy. He thinks like, I wanna fuck that bitch. What am I supposed to say about that? I'm not gonna say anything about it because fuck him. I think that none of the characters in this book hit as hard as they did in Throne, like the characters in Throne of Glass or Ekotar did. And so this is also a huge issue with this book, that Sarah was just putting trust into the characters. But even though Ekotar is the same length as Crescent City, like three books, page count, I don't know, guys. I don't care. People love Ekotar more than they do Crescent City. Crescent City feels kind of like that alien book. Or not alien book, alien baby is what I wanted to say. It's like, it feels like so different from the other two books. I could say that doesn't have to be a bad thing, but for this series, it is a bad thing. People don't give a fuck about the characters in this book. A lot of people don't give a fuck about them. I don't want to generalize everyone, but it includes me. I don't care about them. And so, when I, from the beginning, started getting chapters or perspectives jumping oh my god, she's trying to build tension by skipping from Bryce, who's getting attacked and fighting, to Ethan. Who the fuck is Ethan with an I? Ethan is Connor's brother. Who the fuck is Connor? Connor died in the first book. He was a wolf, and then what's his name? Ethan was really mad about it, obviously, because he's dead. He blamed Bryce for it, and then in the second book he kind of came around, and now in the third book he gets this whole entire dedication. His entire plotline could have been cut from the book. And that includes Therion's plotline. Who the fuck is Therion? That man got on my nerves since book two. I don't know if he got introduced in the first book, or I think he got introduced in his first book and then came like a bigger part in the second book. Go die. I do not give a fuck about either of those two. Therion was the most annoying fuck. He was the Kael of this book. I needed him gone. But Sarah dedicated entire chapters and yapping. There was so much yapping in this book. The characters would not shut the fuck up about things that I did not give a fuck about that weren't relevant to the plot. Literally none of the characters did anything that was of relevance. Everything relevant came from Bryce, the main character of the book. Everything she did was important. Then she would have to meet up with the characters and tell them everything that happened. They didn't do anything. So I'm gonna be very mad when I talk about either Therion or Ethan. I don't even know if I talk about Therion that much. More about Ethan. Therion was also relevant, but he got on my fucking nerves. He was whining the entire time and he didn't do shut the fuck up. Shut the fuck up. I'm gonna sum up her Akutar experience for you guys because it is very, very repetitive and also very boring. Basically, she gets held in the cell and then she breaks out of it because she can teleport. And then she escapes into a tunnel where Nesta finds her. And Nesta is like, what the fuck are you doing down here? And then they go walking and she's like, because she has this star right here, a scar, okay? And it keeps glowing like a fucking flashlight in between her titties. They follow the light wherever it glows the brightest and it's just them walking. And then the next chapter, they're walking. And then they're taking a break, but then they get up and keep walking. So while they are doing that, in the actual Bryce world, I don't know what Midgard is actually what the name of it is. We have Lydia, the Hind, who is still pretending to be evil and torturing our three dudes, the randos, Hunt and Rune and the one random Brian dude. And she's like, I can't do this. I love Rune so much. And he's like, I hate you. Because he found out at the end of the last book that she's the Hind. I hate you, you bitch. You kill people. And she's like, I didn't mean it. I'm actually a rebel. Again, people love Lydia and Rune. I have to be careful of the words that I say. I don't give a fuck for them for the most part. It's just like, I think if they had more time to develop, if this had been a 6-book series, then I would have maybe liked them. But that's not what this is. Also, her big cock evil boyfriend Pollux tells Lydia that the Harpy is coming back. I don't know who that is. I don't remember the Harpy. There are so many characters in Crescent City alone that were mentioned and they were like, oh, this and this character. And I'm like, I don't know who that is. This has no meaning to me at all. She tried to fit the savagery of maybe Throne of Glass, where there's a huge cast of characters that all interconnect somehow, into a 3-book series, and it just didn't work. You know, she just kind of lost the plot, or whatever you say. Maybe she didn't even have one from the start, because this was, like, ass. There's also a random cast of side characters. I think I should have thought of like a funny name for them. Anyway, even more random than this trio in the dungeon is the cast of side characters that just get put together. That includes Therion, Ethan, and two other or three other dudes, and like a girl. We don't care about them. I don't care about them. They have no significance, guys. One of them is a hacker, which is really convenient because he keeps deactivating the cameras whenever they need to break in somewhere, and that's why he's there. Then there's another character. I don't know why he's there. I don't know what his job is. I don't know if he ever even does anything. I think it's Flynn. Flynn, what do you do? I don't even know who that is. He's just along with the people the whole time. He doesn't do anything himself. While everything is going down, this group of characters is like fighting, because at the beginning of the book Therion is under the command of some queen. All of the queens have like cool names, like the Viper Queen and the Ocean Queen and the River Queen. I don't know who's who. Guys, this book is too convoluted. There's too much, too little, too big, too small, too, you know, like I'm doing opposites. I don't know. While Hunt and the boys are being tortured, and then Brian is trying to bite off Rune's hand because they somehow came up with an escape plan that includes him not having a hand. And I don't know because I skimmed it. I did. But they get caught anyway, so it doesn't matter. They get caught and he still loses his hand, so that, you know, was for nothing. Also, this is where we start getting random sussy comments about Rune's dad, which was implemented in the story in the first book's epilogue. When Chasiba and Adidas, his name is not Adidas, obviously, I don't know, his like Adidas or something, Adian, I don't know, everyone has the same name. Chasiba and Adidas were talking about the fact that Chasiba knows Rune's dad very well, and then I got really mad about that because they didn't pick that up in the second book at all, they didn't talk about it. They didn't talk about it. And I said, why mention that in the epilogue if you're not gonna touch on it in the second book at all? And it's because it comes up in the third book. But then it could have been the epilogue of the second book. But that couldn't have been the case because she needs to meet Rhysand, who doesn't do anything in this book. Meanwhile, in the Ekotar world, Bryce is still walking. She's still walking with Nessa, but now Azriel joins them. They were like, oh, I was hiding in the shadows the entire time watching you. And she's like, okay, just walk with us until he walks along. And so the bonus chapters are actually about, I think mostly about the three of them and about the fact that they bond a little bit more, they talk a little bit more, especially that there was like a scene and people were like, oh my god, this means that Azriel and Elaine are mates. It was like the cauldron can be wrong. But all I saw from the bonus chapters was that Azriel's shadows like techno. So I don't really know where people got that from. Because of course Bryce has a phone and so she like shows it to them. She shows them their background and her background photo of Hunt's big penis. No, that's not it, girl. She shows them that there is like a flashlight, which they don't need obviously because Bryce has a star on her chest that just keeps fucking glowing, and that she can take photos and play music, and they're like, oh my god, that's so sick. She explains to them what lasers are and everything. This does not mean anything because they don't actually come to her world to do anything. They're just in the Ekotar world the entire time. It doesn't matter. While following this path that the star is leading them down, they make it to the prison in Ekotar, the big evil prison we remember. And in that prison, they find a hologram. A hologram of a bitch called Selene. Maybe her name was Celine Dion. They find Celine Dion in the cave in a hologram and she's like, hello, ancestor. This is my story. And then we get expose in a monologue. She's watching this hologram with Azriel and Nesta, and Celine Dion is not only singing, but also telling them the story of how the Fae went from the Ekotar world, which was the original world, to Midgard, which is Bryce's world. 15,000 years ago, she went with her mommy. Her name was like Theo and her sister Helena. And it was like the Trojan War. And also there was a library that burned down, which also seems vaguely familiar. And essentially I did mark two passages of that to read out to you guys. But then I also wrote in the same sentence, I just feel like who gives a fuck. So that means I will not read those out to you. I'll just tell you from my mind, which is probably where the inaccuracies will come from. But that's more fun. That's more fun. I'm gonna freestyle it. They're watching the hologram and she's like, 15,000 years ago, we lived in peace. And then the Asteri, they revealed that they were evil because as we know, the Volturi are evil and they feed on the power of the people that live in that world. They eat it to stay powerful themselves, and that can't happen. Which also makes them kind of like vampires. But there are vampires in this world, but they don't matter. I wish there was a vampire in the story. I wish she just did too much, guys. I'm sorry, it just didn't work. Why was there a dragon in the first place? Why was there a dragon in this book? She never did like any dragon things. Who cares? Anyway, 15,000 years ago, let's start again. I just can't get it out. Her mommy, Theo, decided that, okay, that's kind of slay that you can eat people. Actually, no, that's not what she said. She just found out through the Volturi that they can world walk and world travel. Travel between worlds, teleport between worlds, open portals and so on and so forth. And so she said, I want to do that. I want to be the ruler of not just this world, but also other worlds. And so Theo and her two daughters and Paris also, they went to Midgard, which is Bryce's world. And they were like, oh my god, it's kind of nice here, but like, why are there people here? Because she was promised that it would be a world without any people on it. A fresh world for her to take. And she realized she was pranked, kind of like Impractical Jokers, but with magic. That was for all of the Americans. I hope you got that one. I know the lore. Who's your favorite Impractical Joker? And after she realized that this was not it, And she also realized that the Volturi were evil and that Paris was evil. I think she only fought the Volturi and not Paris. Who did she fight? No, she also fought Paris. She fought everybody. Theo fought everybody. That's also not her name. I don't know her name. She started fighting everyone. She said, I'm at war with everyone besides my lovely daughters, Celine Dion and Helena. I'm just so over the place, guys. I'm so sorry. I finished this book like 5 hours ago. I still haven't processed it in my mind. Maybe I should have taken a little sleep. Theo had the ability to travel between worlds. And she also had a bunch of magical artifacts, right, that allowed her to travel between worlds, like the horn and the harp. And so we know from the last Aquitar book that the harp is in the Death Trove, or part of the Death Trove, what the fuck is it called, whatever, Nesta controls it to stop time so that the baby can be born from Pharaoh's pussy and she can change her body to a bear-winged babies. That, you remember that happening? I do. I think about it sometimes and I'm like, turns out that the horn is also part of that scavenger hunt. Oh, what did I call it in my Quarter of Silver Flames review? I gave it a name. Like, they did a scavenger hunt. What else did I call it? Like, Traveler Tournament? Yeah. It is the fourth lost object to the other three things. Like, the mask, the harp, and what was the third one? The crown? I don't actually know. And that the reason the horn stayed in the world, and also the star sword, which we know is Bryce's sword, is because one of the daughters, Celine Dion, who made this hologram, went back to the Aquitar world and world traveled there, while her sister and mother stayed in Bryce's world with the star stone and the horn, and she took the harp and the dagger that Ezreal had. Truth teller. And funnily enough, you know, Ezreal also makes a comment, Celine Dion looks like Rhys's sister. And so what can we gather from all of this very long information? It means that Bryce and Rhys are distantly related. They're cousins. They were sisters, Celine Dion and Helena. And Helena is Bryce's ancestor and Celine Dion is Rhys's ancestor. And they all come from Theo. What does this information give us? Nothing that I couldn't have guessed, honestly. Like, I think I could have come up with that. I feel like this was, like, so insignificant information. It didn't shook me. When I read it, I was like, okay, maybe, you know, that's a good thing, actually, that we could have guessed it. But I just, it didn't feel like a big payoff. I feel like it should have felt bigger than it was. Also, at some point, Nesta puts on the mask to defeat a Midgarden worm. We remember that one from Aquitar where Pharaoh thought it. And she puts on the mask to control a dead skeleton to kill the worm, which is how Bryce finds out what the mask can do. And then she has to take the mask off. And she doesn't want to because the mask is controlling her. And then Ezreal comes up to her and he's like holding her shoulder. And he's like, Nesta, this isn't you. Meanwhile, back home, the random fight a random alpha side girl. And he kills her and is now in deep depression. Yes, he is. Ethan had a fucking girl with him. Her name was Sigrid. How do you say that in English? Do you say Sigrid? In German it would be Sigrid. That's like a grandma's name in Germany. Like, I know a bunch of grandmas named that. She was the alpha that they found in the second book, hidden away, that could challenge the reigning... They could challenge the current ruling... Alpha, who was Daniqua's mommy, and it turns out that to get them out of a situation, Ethan, the random dude that I fucking hate, has to fight her, and he tries to just wound her really badly but not kill her, and then he accidentally rips off her head. On accident, guys, on accident, you know, that just happens to some people sometimes. And then he goes into deep depression. He's like, I have to make this right. I have wolf pride. I can't kill another wolf. I'm a fucking disgrace. You are, because you're fucking boring. Lilia in the Volturi home is now oh my god. She starts freeing them with the help of the Sprite Queen. Like the drink, but the Sprite Queen doesn't really do anything. They come up in the very end, clutch during the battle to burn some shit, but I feel like that doesn't really matter because nobody really cares about them because they were there for like 2 fucking seconds. So whatever, we don't care. Anyway, she gets to free the boys, Hunt, Brian, and Rune. Thank God. The rescue is a success. they make it to the submarine, which is like a really big submarine. It's like a how do you say, like a what, a cruise ship. The cruise ship, yeah, it's like an underwater cruise ship. And Lydia also survives this. She got shot through, she gets shot through the heart, but she survives luckily and also makes it onto the boat. Meanwhile, Bryce, she also makes it back to her own world after killing a slumbering Volturi in the Ekotau world, because she made the ground collapse in the prison. She was like, you know, she did some little jumps and then the floor collapsed and they land in front of a sarcophagus. I just still don't know how to pronounce that word. And there is a woman inside there and they're like, who the fuck is that? They open the crystal sarcophagus. Bryce opens it, to be more specific. She, like, the other bitches wouldn't do that. They're like, who the fuck is that? She must be in there for a good reason. Turns out she's an old Volturi who was locked down there. And then they just kill her. You know, they just kill her. It's like, Nessa just kind of puts her sword through her back and that's like it. They're supposed to be really hard to kill, but at the end of the day, she was in there for 15,000 years, so she was a little weak. She was a little weak. She was alive. She was a little weak. So then by shooting power at the crystal sarcophagus, she opens a portal to her world and makes it back, and then accidentally lands in her dad's house. Her dad is the Autumn King, as we remember. I do not care about the Autumn King. This plot is her arguing a little bit back and forth, learning some things about Truth Teller, the dagger, and the star sword that she has, because she took both of those things with her. Azrael's dagger, she kind of borrowed it, you know? Now, we got back to Ethan, who we absolutely care about. I have never heard anyone say their favorite character was Ethan. I have never even said anyone talk about Ethan, or say anything about him in general. Like, who is that man? He's now working with Jessica. Jessica is, of course, just Theba, who is now revealing that she is a priestess from 15,000 years ago who was there during the burning of the Alexandrian library, and she tried to smuggle some books out, which she succeeded in, but then one of the princes of hell was like, where are you going with that? And she said, I'm just like leaving the burning library. And he said, what is in those books? And she said, I'm not telling you. And he said, okay, hereby I curse you to eternal life until you tell me what's in the books. Okay, so that's why she's still around. Why is Ethan working for Jessica? Jessica is the second in the House of Flame and Shadow, which was the name of the first book, I think.
What the fuck is the name of that book? House of... Oh no, Earth and Blood.
Is this the name of this book? Flame and Shadow? Anyway, forget I said that. And she knows necromancers who can raise the dead, because he now feels so bad in his depressive episode about killing this random side character bitch that he wants to resurrect her. And so they call in a friend called Hypaxia is her name. She comes in, she's like, I am not the witch queen anymore, because she used to be the witch queen. And they're like, what happened? And then she's like, Morgenthia usurped me. And they're like, okay, what can we do about that? And then the other witches never get mentioned again, so I don't really know what they're doing or what they were doing the entire book or why that was relevant at all. I don't even know why Ethan is in this book. I don't know why any of these characters are relevant besides for the very end. Look at how much information I had to retain for nothing. This space in my brain could have been used for something else. Not sure what. While chilling in the cruise ship submarine, Lydia wakes up and Rune wants to apologize to her because after all she rescued them, and he was like, I'm sorry, I was wrong about you. And she's like, I can't talk right now, I have two kids. And Rune is like, you have two kids? And she's like, yeah. No, they actually don't talk. She just gets up and she runs to them and to where they are in school, in class, and looks through the window. And then bitches are like, why are you looking through the window? And she's like, there's my sons in there. I have two children. They're twins. Just because I actually haven't mentioned this yet, but Aelin and the Throne of Glass characters don't make an appearance in this book. My prediction for this book was that after Bryce makes it back to her own world, it was pretty clear to me that we were not going to go back to the Ekotau world. I think that everyone expected different from that plot, and to also just see all of the Ekotau characters and her stay in that world and try to figure something out and not just walk in a fucking tunnel system for 20% of the book. We don't even get to see Feyre. She gets mentioned offhandedly. We get to see Rhys. You know, he's more important. He's the man. but it's your choice. We get a mention of the fucking baby. Who the fuck cares about the baby? I wish the baby would have... Nothing. I wish she lives a happy life. And we don't get the Throne of Glass characters in this book. We get a lot of crumbs about them, a lot of mentions about them. And also through Lydia, who decided to name her son Brannon, like the fucking dude from Throne of Glass, the king that's dead, like the, what was Brannon? Wasn't he like Elena's husband? Wow, that I remember, that is really insane. Maybe he isn't even that, but I think that's true. But her children don't want anything to do with her, especially one of them whose name is like Aceton or something. That's a very like bold name. He's like, fuck you, you're not my mom. I'm being raised by two dads because we're inclusive. Not inclusive enough to make any of the main relevant characters gay. Ted would be a step too far. Aceton hates her, Brannon doesn't really, he's just kind of curious. He likes his dad, but he also likes his mommy. And at the end of the book, of course, they make up. I'm not sure why there are children in this book. Like, I don't really know what relevance they have, if I'm being honest. Again, none of the side characters really have any significance, so I don't know why I'm wondering. The Ocean Queen wants Therion dead, and so does the Viper Queen. Those are two characters I will not mention again. They want Therion dead, they have a bounty on his head, and I wish he would have fucking died! I fucking hate Therion. I hate Therion and Ethan equally, honestly. I think they both deserve death. But they don't die, they survive at the end. Spoiler. During this conversation with the Ocean Queen about Therion and him having to die, Bryce makes her reappearance because she locked her dad in a closet and left and said, fuck you, daddy. I'm going back to Rune. So they go to Rune. No, she goes to Rune. And this is the first time they've seen each other in a while after he made it out of the dungeons and everything. And she's like, I don't want Therion dead. He is under my command or something like that. I don't really know. But it's very like, I think she was very much trying to make Bryce like an Aelin. And it just didn't work because I think Bryce is very unlikable. At least to me, she's very unlikable. Bryce turned to Hunt, who was leaning against the door he'd shut. She arched her brow at her maid at his too calm expression. She knew that look. He was no doubt debating how soon he could kick everyone out and fuck her senseless. There were sex scenes in this book. They were very brief. And they were really bad. They were super bad. They're now on their mission to Avalon, which is the other Fae place. Because there's the Fae with Bryce's king, dad, the Autumn King, I don't know, they're called the Valbaran Fae or something. And then there's the Avalon Fae who live on an island and they're going there to search the archives and also the Star Sword Cave. To find answers on how to kill the Asteri, because that is now the ultimate goal. They want to figure out how to murder the Volturi. She finds out that together the swords, the dagger and the sword can destroy the Volturi. And so that is like the main reason she wants to go look in the archives if she can find anything and into the fucking caves. Because she's like, maybe there's just like some little information for me there. They make it to Avalon and I don't even know if the Autumn King and the Avalon King have names. Or they do actually. I think the Avalon King is like Marvin or something. I don't think I'm getting any of the names right, if I'm honest. And that's like not even me being funny. I just usually remember the first letter of the name and then I'm like, okay, the rest I'll just, you know, make up myself. The Avalon King Marvin is of course very sexist. We need at least one sexist character per book, otherwise we wouldn't meet the quota. And he says, females are only for breeding. And then Bryce is like, okay. I don't think so. And he's like, okay, don't speak like that to me, you worthless pig. Therion ends up marrying a random woman that appears out of nowhere, a random side character that has no reason being there. She doesn't do anything. She's Flynn's sister. Flynn, the dude who I don't know why he's there because he doesn't do anything. She marries Therion because otherwise she wouldn't be allowed to walk around Avalon because she's unwed and she needs to breed. You know how it is with the Fae. Finally, they have sex like 400 pages into the book. And I was so happy that I was getting an infamous Sarah J. Maas sex scene. Because that's what everybody needs when they're doing bad. Stars and planets and rainbow clouds of nebulas swirled around them. Darkness cut with lightning brighter than the sun. Sun and moon held together in perfect balance, suspended in the same sky. I just feel like Sarah J. Maas always obviously over exaggerates her sex scenes, and so she's at a point now where she is running out of like adjectives and things to describe her sex scenes with, so she really has to start like making it intergalactic. Also the fact that they're on top of the submarine and there's like a wave hitting, I'm just gonna read it out. A particularly large wave rocked the depth charger and Hunt was instantly there, a hand at Bryce's back to steady her. Alpha hole, she muttered up at him, but let him see the light dancing in her eyes. He literally just saw you from falling off the fucking ship. On Avalon, one group is exploring the caves and one is exploring the archives. The ones exploring the archives are the randos, including Rune. They don't matter. This is just a subplot so him and Lydia can get it on. And the other two dudes literally get kidnapped and he doesn't even notice it. And if the character in the book doesn't notice his friends being kidnapped, why the fuck should I care about them? At this point, you can really tell that there's not enough substance and that the only character that matters in this book is Bryce. The other characters, you could have not included them and we would have come to the same end of the book. Their work is absolutely unimportant. They don't find anything in the archives that changes anything about their current situation. Bryce is the chosen one, right? She's the Starborn princess. She has the power of the Starborn. She, I didn't even mention this, when she was in Celine Dion's hologram cave, she absorbed Celine Dion's power because she saw in a flashback that Theo, the mother of Celine Dion, Helena, split her power in three. So all three of them have part of Theo's power and Celine Dion's part of Theo's power was stored within the prison, which Bryce absorbed because, you know, she can do that because she's her ancestor. And that is kind of the problem. Bryce gains all of the power because she's related to someone. Whenever there's a challenge or something happening, all of it gets resolved very, very quickly within like the next few pages. It's nothing that goes throughout the book like a red string, as you say in German. Bryce easily resolves everything. Whenever she gets a new ability, she keeps getting power-ups throughout the story, right? It's very, it reminds me very much of like a anime. I can say that. I have the anime, the power of anime and God on my side. She kept absorbing power, getting a new weapon, getting a new ability, mastering it immediately. There was like no epic training montage. I would have liked an epic training montage. But she just keeps getting stronger and stronger because she's the chosen one. That is the entire reason anything happens. And since nothing relevant happens to the other characters, it's so Bryce focused and I don't like her. I don't like her attitude. I think she's not a likable character. She was quirky and sassy in the first book. And I think I didn't have anything bad to say about her during like the first book. Reading that one was fine. But it kind of infuriated me the way she just always thought she was better than everyone. It's kind of the point I'm trying to make. I just didn't really enjoy her character. She also hates the Fae because as we know, she's half human, half Fae. She does not want to lead the Fae. She doesn't want to lead them. She says, I don't want to unite them. I don't want them to have any rights. I hate the Fae. She doesn't, or she appears to not really think anything through very well. Her ultimate goal is to just end the Volturi, and that is it. Like, her plan stops there. But I think if you're trying to overthrow the government, you have to think a little bit further. Because everyone's like, so you're gonna be queen of the Fae then? And she's like, no, I don't want to be queen of the Fae. I hate the Fae. I don't want to do that. And then she ends up being Fae of the Queen, and she... Fae of the Queen, did I say that? She ends up being Queen of the Fae and she doesn't mind. No, she doesn't mind. She doesn't mind. Anyway, and it appeared a little bit inconsistent to me. And I just don't like Bryce. While his friends are kidnapped, Rune has a conversation with Lydia, who's there slowly getting it on. They're talking about the fact that she didn't think a prince like him could be a rebel, okay? You're the defiant, partying prince. You have all those piercings and tattoos. I didn't have you down for being a rebel. Heh? Hasn't he been rebelling with tattoos and piercings and parties against his father's wishes his entire fucking life? Was this supposed to be a joke? It wasn't a joke though. She like truly, this is like a serious conversation. It's not like in a funny way like, haha, I didn't think additionally to that you would be a rebel. No, she means it like, I didn't think you were going to be a rebel. Why the fuck did she not think that? Anyway, at some point they realized that her or his random side character friends, the hacker and the random dude that doesn't do anything, are gone. They're gone. They're nowhere to be found. So they go into the caves to look for them. And they can send that they are in the caves somewhere where also the other characters are, so they're about all to join. About all to join, guys. And instead of focusing on the task at hand, she's like, you make me horny, I want to ride you. And then he gets horny from that, and he gets a boner, and he's like, the phrase wraps hard around my cock fell so often. I don't even know when he didn't have a boner. You're literally looking for your kidnapped friends and you want to fuck in the cave? They don't though, guys, don't worry about it. But turns out they find a cave in the caves, right? This cave is full of salt, and when you consume the salt, you can talk to hell. Which, as we remember, that's where Adidas is from, who told Bryce to join his forces to march against the Volturi, and she was like, I don't trust you, because they were always told that hell are the bad people. That's where all the demons and stuff are from. Ew. Ugh. But her and Hunt are now able to communicate with Hell, and it turns out that Hell, or Adidas to be more specific, actually all of them, you know, they were all around when everything happened 15,000 years ago, that they knew all of that information. They knew everything about the sword and the dagger and Theo and the sisters. So there was no reason for Bryce to even go to the Equator world, if we're being real. Since Hell knew all of the information, Adidas at that, who's like her bestie babe, he could have just told her, but then he says, oh, I didn't tell you because you weren't ready. Ah, okay, that explains it. So for me, I got kind of frustrated at this point because I just felt like she did the whole Equator crossover just for fan service, you know? I mean, at the end of the day, she did get Thea's power from, oh my god, her name is Thea. No, it's with an I. Thea. Theo, we'll stay with Theo. She did get part of Theo's power, which at this point means she has like 2/3 of the power, right? Because she's missing 1/3 from Thea herself, because she has a part from Helena's bloodline, then the one she absorbed from Celine Dion, and then she needs Theo's third part that's hidden somewhere to fully activate her power. So she's just collecting all of the Dragon Balls, and she's actually hoping to just level up completely in the end. It's also revealed that Hunt was made specifically for Bryce. Throughout the 15,000 years, Hell was waiting for someone like Bryce to come along that was worthy and powerful. And so they kept making people with lightning ability, because they knew that if that time came, they needed someone to fire up Bryce. Because she works like a battery, remember? She absorbs power and then uses it on her own. And they didn't know when she was gonna come along, so they kept making Thunderbirds, which were relevant in the second book, which are not relevant in this book. There's just too much going on. They tell her that she needs to find the third part, or the final power, to become the almighty and successful Star One princess, the one chosen one, the true leader of the universe, or whatever. And then 5 minutes later, she wakes up in the cave, surrounded by her father and Prince Marvin, who are now like, we're gonna kill you. But instead, Rune kills his father, and Bryce kills sexist King Marvin, literally within 2 seconds. And she absorbs the final part of the power, because it was like down there or something. It was hidden somewhere in the cave. And now she has all of the power. So 2 seconds after being told that she needs to find it, she finds it and gets it, and then she kills the kings without any issue. It just doesn't feel satisfying at all, the way that this plot progresses and the way that anything happens. It just does not feel that nice. So we, Ethan and the random witch queen, make it to the island Avalon, which is now also freed of its shackles because the king is dead, and Bryce is not a fake queen, right? Because she killed both king, or Rune killed one of the kings, but he's like, I yield to you. So now she's the fake queen. And Ethan pulls up and he's like, what happened here? And it turns out the entire island is refurbished. No, what is it called? Anyway, it's refreshed, right? Has its life back. There's like random islands rising around the island that sunk 15,000 years ago because the island was drained of its magic, and there's trees and flowers and everything. And Ethan is like, what's going on? What are you guys doing? You're being so silly. Also, at some point they figured out that the Steri had poisoned the water with a parasite, which means that they need to remove this parasite from the water. Every water in the world is poisoned. This water makes it so that they have to take the drop, which is something that's unique to this book that the other books didn't include. And the drop means that part of the power of the people gets taken away from them and put to the Volturi for them to consume to stay in power, you know? And the way that this happens is because there's a parasite in the water that's implemented into your head when you consume the water. And so the random witch queen that's also a healer and a necromancer luckily turns up with Ethan, who we don't care about, and then she's like, stop. Random witch queen, you need to go and cure COVID. You need to go cure this parasite right now. And she's like, okay, I guess. It's not like I had anything to do. I'm not queen anymore. Help us level up before we take the Volturi. Get us free of their restraints. I just felt like I need to read something out to you guys to prove that this actually happens in the book. She literally says, I need you to do it again. Help us level up. Help us level up! And she finds the antidote within one day to the parasite. Yeah, I know. We're already 500 pages into the book. We're almost done. They also find out that the Volturi attacked some area and destroyed a bunch of buildings and killed some people. And they're sad about it for 2 seconds and then they move on about it. Her parents get flown into the newly claimed Fae Island that Bryce is now queen of, the Avalon Island, along with her two friends, Juniper and Furry, or, Furry is how I always say it's Fury, but, you know, Furry sounds better. They have no relevance in this book. This is the only scene that they appear in. They get mentioned like 2 or 3 times, but this is the only like actual scene they appear in. And that just shows you that there are too many characters because they did not get any screen time and they are literally there to do nothing. They don't do anything. They want to let the armies of Hel come into Midgard, so she has to go to the Northern Rift, is what it's called, to open the portal for them, okay? Ethan is now super strong after taking the antidote. He tests it, and he goes to the wolves to reveal to them everything that's been going on, because they don't know. Because the Volturi are keeping all of this information away from the people, obviously. He goes to the wolves, he's like, hey guys, I know you haven't seen me in a while. I actually have to tell you some crazy news. And then there's only one girl called Perry who is making them listen. And I have to be honest, like, the only Perry that I think of is not Perry the Platypus, but Perry Cox from Scrubs. So the entire time they were mentioning Perry with her strawberry and cinnamon scent, I was just imagining Perry Cox. This plotline is so rushed, guys. Who the fuck gives a fucking fuck about Ethan? He goes there, he's like, this and this happened. Then Sabine, who is the Nequa's mom, pulls up, who's the current alpha or whatever. She's like, he's lying, and here's Sigrid, who is, by the way, now a Reaper, which whatever the fuck Reapers are, I have no idea, guys. I don't know what any of these people do. I don't know what any of it means. She's now a Reaper, and she is my heir, because now she was resurrected as a Reaper and not as herself, and so that means she's now evil, and she, I don't know what she does. Anyway, she's my heir, and then the Prime comes, which I thought that Sabine was the Prime, but apparently there's a different Prime, who's Sabine's dad. He comes out, he's super old. He needs crutches and shit. That means he's old. He's like, sorry, I heard everything Ethan just said and it's true, so I'm making Ethan my heir and also an alpha. And then Sabine is like, no, you can't do that. And then Sabine kills her father, the Prime. And then you're like, oh my god, what's going on? And then Ethan is like, no, I'm telling the truth. And he shifts into a wolf super fast and is like, I'm gonna destroy the sword, the really important sword from your bloodline. And he destroys the sword and he's like, fuck you, bitch. And then he kills Sabine, which now he is the Prime of the wolves. And the wolves are watching, they're like, what is going on? Sigrid, meanwhile, she's also there. She absorbs the souls of some people and then she leaves. And that's it. So now Ethan is Prime. This has no relevance because, again, like, the only person that cares about him is Perry Cox. I hope she doesn't want to make a spin-off about Therion or Ethan. She's definitely setting them up to be their own stories, but who the fuck gives a fuck about any of those characters? I'm being so serious. Even people who like this book, do you give a fuck about Ethan? With an eye? They make it to the Rift. At the Rift, Bryce decides to not open a portal to Hel to let the armies in, but instead open a portal to the Ekotal world. And Nesta is just sitting there by the fire reading a book. She turns around, she's like, what the fuck are you doing here? In the back, we can see Rhys approaching. Rhys is approaching, he's super fast, he's super angry. The stars are winking out, and I'm like, I don't fucking care, you know? Rhys, get in line of characters I hate. fuck off. Bryce is like, please, I really, really, really need the mask. I saw you raise the dead with the mask. I need to lend it from you. Like, sorry, here, take my parents. She gives Nesta her human parents into the Ekatar world and then takes the mask and closes the portal. So now her parents, who didn't know that this was going on, are in the Ekatar world and she has the mask. She trades her parents in. She sold her parents to One Direction. Then the harpy appears. Did you remember I mentioned in the beginning the harpy? She appears and it was hyped up. Apparently she was really big in the first or second book. I don't remember who she is. She's now raised from the dead. She has risen. And so this was hyped up like, oh my god, so scary. Bryce puts the mask on and just kills her with one thought. So that was a super exciting fight that the buildup was definitely worth it for. It was sickening, and yet it was a relief as the harpy's eyes closed and she collapsed into the ground. As the skin began to wither, her body reclaiming the form it had known in death. It is sickening! This book is sickening in a bad way. I think sickening means like it's good, then this book is anti-sickening. And then Celestina and Naomi and Isaiah pull up. Those are actually the names. Why do I remember them? I'm scared. Anyway, maybe because they came at the very end of the book. They pull up and they're actually the governor of the city. Celestina is the governor of the city who sold them out in the second book. And she's like, no, I'm good now. Like, they launched an attack on the humans and now I'm mad at the Volturi. I'm on your side now. And then we just decide to trust them. And then I don't really know. Like, they're like, okay, you're gonna lead the dead that are going to be risen. I don't know. I just, guys, I'm so sorry. Like, I don't know what's going on. Also, Hunt had a slave mark on his, I would say chin. No, that's not it. What's this? Forehead. And he just removes it himself. He figures out, oh my god, I didn't even tell you guys who his dad was. I completely skimmed over that. Hunt finds out while they were talking to Hel about the fact that Bryce needed the third power, which she then got 2 minutes later. It was revealed that Hunt was actually like a test tube baby, and that is literally what they call it on page. Did I? Oh, no, I mentioned that, right? But anyway, he was made for Hel. No, he was made for Bryce by Hel, which indirectly makes him a son of Hel. And so he is like, oh my god, I don't know, I'm not doing good mentally, and now I'm a son of Hel. And Bryce is kind of like the entire book, like, get over it, like, I get it, but like, kind of get over it. I also went through some traumatic shit in the Ekatar world with the fucking worm. You were in a dungeon and almost had to bite someone's hand off. That doesn't compare, like, my story is worse. And it's like, okay, she's very unlikable. So this means that he can just remove the mark from his forehead himself because the marks don't hold people from Hel. And since he is partially from Hel, because he was like implemented in his mother's womb, that makes it so he can remove it. There's not really any significance to this. It's not like it challenged him in any way during the entire book from doing anything, because he was, I don't know, he always had enough power to do everything he wanted, so I don't really know why we care. This is the plan, okay? Now she has the mask. She can raise the dead with the mask, as we remember, from A Court of Silver Flames. Don't read that book if you haven't. It's really bad. They're just fucking the entire time. You're not missing anything. Just watch my review. Declan can hack into their computer system and block Imperial access while the souls of them, of the fallen, fuse with the mech suits and pilot them under Naomi and Isaiah's command. We need those suits piloted by the Fallen, or they'll be used against us by the Volturi. We need the Volturi and their forces entirely occupied. I imagine them like the suits from Avatar. Not The Last Airbender, but the other one, the blue one. Where they're walking around Pandora in these big-ass metal suits. So that's probably how she imagined them too, I'm gonna be honest. And she wants to put the souls of the dead into those mechanical suits to kill the Asteri. Honestly, I thought this was gonna have or be more important. These suits were gonna be more important, as they are in the end. They are not important. Everything works out for them. Everything works out for them because they planned everything. Oh my god, they could predict everything that happened. Really weird plan. Like, the whole technical aspect of this book is just, I don't fuck with it. Meanwhile, the not anymore queen of the witches, who's cured COVID, also decides to take on the Underking. The Underking is the king of the dead. Basically, Ethan was like, I have to go talk to my brother Connor, and he's dead. So he went to the Underking and said, can I talk to my brother? He said, yeah, for 7 minutes. Then he comes back and from the dead, and they talk, but he actually can't talk, just Ethan can talk, and I need him to shut up. He's not enough talking. we need him to be quiet. So I don't actually know how it happens, but Ethan, since he took the antidote against the parasite, he is able to wield ice magic, because all of the people that can shift into animal forms are from, or originally from, the Throne of Glass world, where the Fae have human forms and animal forms and elemental magic, as you remember, like Rowan with his fucking bird shit, and you know. And he realizes he has ice power, he freezes the Under King, and then the queen comes, the ex-queen, the ex-witch queen comes, and she kills the Under King, and then it's like, congratulations, you're now the Under Queen. So that's convenient. We have the Prime and the Under Queen. Okay. I actually don't know the last thing that I talked about, but I slept a night. And so I just want to make clear why I think this book sucked. I think everybody, including me, expected some kind of grand interwining of the different worlds that she had, right? And I absolutely think that will happen, whether that's in the next Ekotal book or some other book. I think she's gonna merge them all together at one point, but she just didn't do it in this book, and I think a lot of people's expectations were let down through that. Not that I'm that hardcore of a stan at this point in my life that I would say that it broke my heart or anything. But honestly, if this would have happened when I was 14, when I still thought Sarah J. Maas was the best writer in the whole universe, I would have been really sad about it. And so I feel sad for that 14-year-old that just got into reading and is reading Throne of Glass, and I'm gonna start crying. No, just kidding, I'm not that sad. But I do have a pimple patch on in the shape of a star, fitting with the star theme. Let's just finish it. We actually stopped talking about it at the best point. I think the last thing that I mentioned, now that I'm looking at my notes, is the fact that one of the witches, the ex-witch queen, became the queen of the underworld, or the under queen, which is where the dead people go. And so Connor, who is Ethan's with an eyes brother, gives him a bullet because he wants him to kill himself. Just kidding. It's fueled with the second light of the soul. So before they go into whatever, into the ether, they give off another surge of energy. So there's the first light and there's the second light. The first light is the one with the drop that the Asteri Volturi consume, and the second light, I don't know what that goes. I don't know what happens with that one. But Connor was still lingering around and then decides to give him a fucking bullet. I don't know what they're doing in the death realm to be crafting bullets and shit, but he gives him one and is like, all of our second light is in this bullet. Use it wisely. And he's like, okay. So the evening before the big battle, of course, it's really scary because you could potentially never see your loved ones again, and especially not your big-dicked boyfriend. And so what do you do the night before you're going to die? You have sex. That's what they're doing. I mentioned my review for the book earlier that I talked about the fact that Hunt doesn't fit into any underwear because his dick is so big. That's in the book. I didn't make that up. I kind of exaggerated it a little bit, maybe. Hunt chuckled, rising up to unbuckle his belt, then unzipping his pants. So impatient. She rubbed her thighs together, desperate for any friction, especially at his impressive length, of course, sprang free and Commando Bryce said, why am I reading like this? Commando Bryce said, choking. Hunt smirked. All the underwear they gave me on the depth charger, which is the submarine cruise ship, was too small for this. He palmed himself, pumping. And she groaned at the sight of the small bead of moisture at the tip of his cock. So I was reading this, I was just like, sorry, what the. Because there was absolutely no reason to put this in the book. I mean, you can argue that sex scenes in general don't have any. Any meaning behind them. They're in there for fan service, or you don't need sex scenes to understand a book or to progress a book further. Maybe you can also just leave it off page. But then writing a sex scene and explicitly mentioning that he can't wear the underwear because his dick is so big is really like it's a very interesting bold move. Now the day of doom arrives, and the plan is, because actually Lydia's kids, oh my god, her kids were kidnapped by Pollux, who's her ex-boyfriend with a mega schlong, and he's keeping them hostage, and she's like, I have to get my children. So the children are in this book so she can get the children. Maybe, no, I actually don't think so. I was gonna say, maybe she's setting up the story for the kids, so she can write about the kids' story at one point, like Cassandra Clare does, but we... That woman needs to stop writing. Get the kids, kill the Volturi, and destroy the First Light Corps, because apparently there's a First Light Corps in the Volturi castle that fuels all of them, and they're like, okay, we have to destroy it. And they want to distract everybody, like all the guards and everything, while they're doing it. I don't think they plan on like killing them just outright. They just want to destroy the core and hope that that will kill them in the same breath. While they are executing this plan, Bryce puts on the mask that she got from Nessa for training in her parents, puts it on and commands the souls of the fallen, which are stored in their wings, because the Volturi, I keep wanting to say Asteri, but I have to go through with it now. Bryce and Hunt are in a room in the Volturi castle where there are a bunch of wings on the wall, and those wings belong to all of the soldiers and angels that the Volturi conquered and killed, and so they still have their souls attached to them because they didn't get to pass into the ether. I don't know why I keep saying that. I just don't know where they're going. And so Bryce puts on a mask and tells them, go into the suits, into the machine suits, and fight and, you know, kill everybody. And they listen to her. They do that. But while she's doing this, we have the dude pull up. Rigolus. What's his name? His name is Rigolus. But how do you say that? You don't say Rigolus, do you? That's the same vibe as arugula. Arugula tells them, hey, I know what you were doing in the Northern Rift, opening the portal so Hell could put his army through. Like, I don't know why you thought we wouldn't notice. The Harpy literally told us, the Harpy that they killed in 1 second. I have sent my army to the Northern Rift to destroy the army. Bryce is like, oh no, we have to go warn Adidas. So she teleports them out, away from Arugula, and tells Adidas, ha! He fell right into his trap, because of course Bryce planned this and knew that they were gonna be aware somehow that they are opened the portal to Hell and had left people through, and so there's a bunch of soldiers staying back at the Rift portal to kill the evil people. Yeah, okay. Good. Bryce's plan was to distract the Volturi and then go into the castle. She wasn't supposed to fight, she was just supposed to go into the castle and destroy the core. So as they're facing off against all of the Volturi, I don't even know if we know all of their names, I'm gonna be honest. I feel like there was 6 Volturi for no reason, like I don't even know half of them. I know like 2 by name. Arugula is not there. He's somewhere else. Doesn't matter. He doesn't fuck with them. He's the boss. Bryce decides, I don't fucking care that I plant this with you. I'm gonna fight the Volturi right now. And so she kills one of the Volturi with the swords by... No, not swords. It's one sword and a dagger. She combines the blades, which opens a black hole, and it sucks the Volturi inside of it. And then everyone's like, okay, that's scary. Inside the castle, Rune and Lydia are trying to find the children. They get ambushed by Pollux. It's a whole drama thing, but luckily for some reason, Therion arrives, the dude that nobody cares about. He's a mermaid. He arrives, he has some antidotes with him because as we know, COVID is cured, and he gives Lydia one because she was shot in the leg by a rune. Doesn't matter what happened. She was shot in the leg and she can't heal herself and they're getting hunted. So he's like, okay, I have 2 doses. How do you say it? Doesn't matter. I was going to give to Rune and Bryce, but now that you're like bleeding, I'm going to give one to you. And then she takes it and she's like, it's like they're on crack or something. It turns out she is somehow related to Aelin. First of all, she can turn into a hind, which I thought a hind was like some type of wolf, but I think it's a deer. What is a hind? This is what Lydia is. And of course we know everything. I don't want to spoil people. And then like related to Throne of Glass, and then of course she also has fire powers and they're now activated and they're like so strong. She always had them, elemental magic, But now she's exploding with fire. And then she's like in her head, like, oh my god, maybe that's why I named my son Brandon. Like the old sayings about a king named Brandon and blah, blah, blah. It's like, okay, bitch, like just put Throne of Glass into the fucking book at this point. Like you're really grasping at straws. You're giving us the crumbs, but you can't have the cake and eat it too. What does that mean? So you're gonna say, Sophie, why does it say, oh, you can't even read it, power of friendship on the board? That's got to be related to this book somehow, or do you just want the power of friendship? No. It's related to the book. Gets the bullet from Ethan. Fuck him. I hope he dies in the next book. She gets the bullet and is talking to Arugula. Arugula is telling her, don't shoot the first light core with this bullet. This is a kill switch for the world, meaning if she shoots it, there will be death. Everybody will die. Everything will be sucked into a black hole if she shoots it, because that's the way they are trying to ensure that no one will ever destroy the first light core, because then that would mean the entire world vanishes, and they are just like the Volturia thinking, no one's gonna do that, no one's gonna want to kill everybody in this world. And so Bryce is like, I literally don't care, and shoots it, and then the black hole opens obviously as a consequence and starts sucking everything in, including the Volturia, including Arugula. And Bryce, in consequence, opens another black hole that is consuming the first black hole. Okay, there's like a black hole in a black hole. She opened the second one, and the first one is in the second one. And she does this so that it doesn't consume the entire world, right? It's like contained within another black hole. She was going very spacey in this book. She was really trying to do something supernova. She doesn't even mention that, whatever. Not sure where all of this astrology, astronomy, probably is coming from all of a sudden. Bryce also gets sucked into this black hole. Oh no. In there, there is no air. Tell me how I'm supposed to breathe. No air. She can't. She can't breathe. All of the Volturia are in there, including Arugula. They're all slowly getting sucked into the true black hole, like the nothingness, whatever. And after one another, she can see how some of them are clinging to one another, and then Arugula, I think someone's clinging onto Arugula, and he just kicks them off. He's like, fuck off, bitch. And she's like, oh my god, he's so cruel. And then he clings onto her, and she's like, no, you fuck off now. And then she, I don't even know what she does, actually. I don't know if she uses power or whatever, but she somehow gets free from him, and then it turns out that she does have air, but not enough, and then she's dead. She dies in the black hole. Bryce is dead, which we don't know at this point, because right now we're in Hunt's perspective, and Adidas is telling him, I think she's dead, and he's like, that can't be, I'm going in. And then Adidas is like, do you want to die with her? Like, you also want to be dead? You're doing like a pact, like some other characters that we know? And then one of the fallen angels that were activated through the mask and are now, or have their souls in the mechanical suits, comes up to him. And he looks at this robot. And he's like, my ex-girlfriend? His ex-girlfriend's soul is in the robot. And she's like, because she can't speak, she's a robot, she's just like a suit. And then the pilot hole opens, and he climbs inside, and he's like, I can save her if I go into space, into the black hole, in this suit, with the soul of my dead girl. No fanfiction writer could have thought of this, because this is so bad that no one would even dare to come up with such an idea. But it's actually the book, it's actually the lore, you know? How do you say it's actually canon? Well, funny that we speak of canons, because he goes into the black hole and he sees Bryce floating around and like unconscious and dead, and he grabs her, and then he fires a missile to, or a cannon to, first of all, shoot Arugula into the black hole indefinitely, because there's like a, I don't fucking know what's going on. He dies, and then with his last strength, he makes it out of the black hole with the help of a cannon firing off and boosting him. He takes Bryce out, everybody's outside looking into the hole, looking at them, waiting for her. I think at this point it's like Hunt looks up and sees the face of Jessica, of Declan, of Rune, of Lydia. Everybody is like looking into black hole like this, like literally they're like, oh, Adidas and Apollyon, which I don't fucking, Apollyon, who the fuck is that, who the fuck cares? Thanatos? Thanatos, someone, some bitches pull up, you know, I didn't even mention them. They're all looking into the black hole, they're all trying to hold it open so that Hunt and his dead girlfriend Sol and Bryce can come back through the hole because it's closing up, the portal is closing up since Bryce is dead and it's not staying open, and they make it out. Power of friendship, guys. The power of friendship makes it possible. This is like some fucking Yu-Gi-Oh! Ass plot. Yu-Gi-Oh! Would have not done that shit. It literally says in the book, the friends they'd made were what mattered in the end, not the enemies. Through love, all is possible. It's not a bad message to have in your book, that the power of friendship will defeat all evil. But do I want that to be the conclusion of an epic crossover fantasy finale? No. I want bitches to die. At this point, obviously, Bryce is dead. As I mentioned, you're gonna say, Sophie, what are we gonna do about it? What are we gonna do about it? Don't you worry, because we're gonna do something about it. And what we're gonna do about it is Jessica, who used to be Bryce's boss in the first book, and then I don't know what she did in the second book, and in the third book, I also don't know what she did. She comes forward and she says, listen, I've been alive for 15,000 years. I was a priestess, a human priestess, and I got cursed by Apollyon because he thought that there was some shit in the books that I was keeping safe. There isn't any shit in the book that she's keeping safe. So he cursed her to eternal life until she reveals what's in the book. Multiple books. And she cannot die until then. And she wants to be fucking dead. So what she says is so honorable. She says, I'll trade my life for Bryce's. I will die so Bryce can live. Mm-hmm. They meet in like this in-between world, and all I could think about, like, so honorable of her, like, thank you for doing this, for saving her. Of course, we appreciate it. Where would we be without Bryce? All I could think about was the fact that this had such One Direction Imagine vibes. You know those Imagines where they would be like, the character YN would go into surgery, and then she came out and she was like, where's Harry? And then the person would say, who do you think gave you the heart? And that's all I could think about. That's how it is read. And that's not a good thing. Bryce comes back to life, more powerful than ever, and she's like, okay guys, I'm back. Fuck the patriarchy. Yeah, fuck the patriarchy, but also fuck the monarchy. I will abolish the monarchy, and we are all going to be living in a democracy now. Woohoo! Everybody is happy. Everybody gets a happy end. Nobody died besides Jessica and the Volturi, and not even Ethan with an eye, not even fucking Therion with a fucking fishtail, not even any fucking body died, not even Reese. I need him dead! Keep him dead! I think that this book was her worst book, and she's written a bunch of books, and she's written a bunch of bad books too. Like, I fucking hate Eklatar, the first book, ugh, so bad. But this, honestly, how do you say in German? It shot the bird. This one shot the bird. I don't know what I'm supposed to do with myself now. Literally, the ending of the book is Bryce and Hunt running somewhere hand in hand, and the last line of the book is just the word together. Sorry. It feels so unsatisfying because I feel like Bryce did not deserve any of the things that happened. Like, any of the good things that happened to her. I didn't like her, and there was no character that I particularly liked that made me want to finish this book. I just finished it because I have a YouTube channel. I have an obligation. Also, I wanted to know what was going on. I'm gonna be honest, I wanted to know how it ends because I wanted to see everybody together fighting evil together. But she didn't do it. What does she want to put in the next Eklatar book? What's that gonna be about? There is no threat. How do you write a book about something where there's no threat? The characters exist and they have nothing to fear. But there is nothing else for me to say besides one star, fuck you. The thing that's gonna be most memorable for me from this book when I think back on it will be the fact that Hunt has a big, huge penis and can't wear any underwear. Like, you really had to emphasize it and tell us he has such a huge schlong that he cannot wear underwear. Like, it can't get any bigger than this. I really just need, like, all of the Sarah J. Maas men to line up their dicks so I can see. Are they all the same size? Does she imagine some bigger than others? I have no idea. At this point, I have no idea. I also don't know. I think she signed multiple books with Bloomsbury or whoever her publisher is. Eckhart is definitely getting a sixth book. What is it gonna be about? What is it gonna be about? I don't know. I'll read it though. I'll read it because I'm just nosy. But I don't know how she'll come back from this. I've seen people say, oh my god, this was AI generated. Don't let AI generate your books. It will end up like this. And at some point, like, it's still read like a Sarah J. Maas book. You got male and female at least 5 times on one page, every page. But it just felt like it lacked the substance. And some sentences were just really odd. Not saying that she let AI write this. I don't think that was it. I just think she doesn't have a good editor. Or maybe she is such a, like, highly viewed author at this point that she only has yes men around her and that no one's telling her, hey, maybe you shouldn't do this. The only thing they tell her to do is to cut out the threesome scenes in her books. And honestly, I also think that's a good thing, but maybe make her cut out more. It's a good start. Make her, like, put the pen down. You guys let me know what you thought about the book. I feel like I didn't tell you anything. It was just me rambling for 1.5 hours. But they're really just, she always, but it's just in true Sarah J. Maas fashion where everything leads up to a final show off or battle in the last 5 chapters. And that's what you're working towards for the entire book. And I feel like there are no things throughout the story that make it worth, how do I put this, worthwhile? Does that even make sense? There is only a huge payoff at the end. There should have just been other things going on, guys. What am I supposed to say? I've said enough. I've said my piece. Anyway, I hope you enjoyed this video. I am back and I'm not better than ever. I'm still the same, but I'll do more videos now in February. My exams are over. I don't have any results yet. Keep your fingers crossed for me, but I'll try my best to film more and upload more in February. I'm really, like, thank you to everybody, and but also especially thank you to my members who were so patient with me throughout January, so I have to make it up for you guys with more rants. Anyway, I hope you enjoyed this video. Please let me know your opinion in the comments below, not about me, but about the book. I love you so much. I hope you stay happy, you stay healthy, peace and love, and hopefully I'll see you in my next video. Bye bye.